I've mixed some of the biggest club and rap records to have ever come out and that are known for their huge bass, like... Put your hood up! Put your hood up! Put your hood up! And... And this... And that's actually kind of funny because before all that, I was known as a guy who played the mandolin and sang songs about spirits and angels. Nowadays, people think I helped invent the sound of Southern rap, specifically the low end, which is, it's a nice thought, but it's actually not true. I was just one guy in the long evolution of a particular sound. So here's the story. When someone says to me, turn up the 808, or we need to change the 808, they're referring to the large booming bass drum or sub bass you hear in most songs today. And that sound originally came from a drum machine which has been used on more hit records than any other drum machine in history, and that would be the Roland TR-808. This episode is going to focus on the TR-808's bass drum, how it changed over the years, why it changed, how it impacted music, and how it changed how we even listen to music. But first, I'm going to give you some background on the birth of the Roland TR-808. The first drum machines were simple, pre-programmed units, often built into organs. You couldn't change the sound, you couldn't change the pattern, you couldn't even change the arrangement of the patterns. In the late 60s, the Hammond Organ Company was selling organs with these primitive drum machines built into them. They had hired Don Lewis to be a product demonstrator specifically to show off the built-in drum machine. These drum machines were made by the Japanese company Ace Tone and were considered quite innovative at the time. Now, Lewis was not very satisfied with the drum machine, so he somehow altered the design so that he could create his own drum patterns. After hearing what he had done, Ace Tone president and founder, Ikutaro Kakahashi, hired him immediately. After working together for a while, Kakahashi created the Roland Corporation in 1972, and he made Lewis the principal designer of their drum machines. By the late 1970s, microprocessors were starting to be used in instruments, and Roland used this technology to create the CompuRhythm CR78, which was the first commercially available drum machine on which you could write, save, and replay your own patterns. It was well received, but they really wanted to create something that was more for the professional market, a drum machine that allowed you to change the tuning, the tone, and the decay of the drum sounds. This is what led to the development of the TR-808. At the time, their nearest competitor was Lindrum and their expensive Lin LM1 drum machine, which used samples of real drums. Kakahashi wanted to create something distinctive yet more affordable than the Lindrum. The high cost of memory needed to play back samples drove them to create drum sounds using sound-generating synthesis instead. And they also used faulty transistors to give it a unique sound. The TR-808 was launched in 1980 with a list price of $1,195, which is the equivalent of about $4,000 in 2021 dollars. But people hated it. It just didn't sound like real drums. I had actually bought a TR-909, which is very similar to that, and I tired of it pretty quickly and sold it for $50. And I spent a lot of money on that thing. In fact, it wasn't long before you could find TR-808s on the used market for under $100. So, after building about 12,000 units, Roland quit making the TR-808 in 1983. But then people started using them because now anybody could afford them, and it just had this sound.
I The first time I heard an 808, I didn't know it was an 808. You know, it was just a sound. The 808 to me is a vibe. Before I even knew what it was, the records that contained 808 made me, it sparked something in me.
Yeah.
I can go back to as early as some of the early hip hop records, like Run DMC and Rick Rubin would use the 808 in some of their earliest records. It's Yours by T La Rock. Hmm. And that record, it drew me in. Mm-hmm. You're gonna start there. So I was drawn to it before I even knew what it was.
And of course, we can't forget this song for helping popularize the sound. Just get on down and hit me. Bambata's getting so fucking hit me. Yeah, just hit me. It's time to chase your dreams. Now I'd like to explain something right here before we go any further, and that is there is no 808 on the TR-808. And what I mean when I say that is what everybody's hearing is what they called the bass drum. And it was designed so that you could pitch it down, pitch it up, make it longer, make it shorter. So when we got these machines, we were thinking we were trying to make it sound like a real kick drum. So people would typically do something kind of like this. These are samples from one of the original machines I have on my computer here. So you'd have something like this, you know. It's kind of like a muffled kick drum. Maybe you'd go like that, or it might be a little longer. You know, but it never really sounded like a real bass drum to me, which is why I didn't like these machines. People started turning that decay knob and the pitch knob down, so you'd start to get into areas like this. Kind of cool. Then they really, you know, cranked it down, so it was like this. And then they went... But I remember thinking to myself, why would you want your kick drum to sound like that? Well, apparently a lot of people did. I was starting to hear bass drums that hit harder than any I'd ever heard before. And hip-hop record producers were taking the sound of that bass drum even further.
I used the original drum machine very limited. I had access to it, you know, for a short period of time, but I never got into it enough to freak it and manipulate it the way some of these older producers did. Once the SP-12 drum machine was introduced to the game, everybody was sampling drums from either drum machines, other records, or whatever.
Yep.
So when I got introduced to MC Shy D, the 808 that I got from him I used for years, all the Yin Yang stuff and all that. I don't know where he got his original 808, the one that he used in Shake It. Let me see you. That was the drum kit that he used. I love it because it was so clean. And it might have even came from DJ Tump, who was producing for him before I got with him. So it may very well be Tump's 808, for all I know. And it filled up the speaker.
Yes.
It rounded up the speaker in a way that no other kick that I've sampled has that same feel to it. So that just goes to show you how different that one machine, that sub from that one machine, and it's still carrying on to this day.
I had started mixing hip hop and rap records here and there in the, I guess, the mid 90s.
Right.
But by the late 90s, I was way deep into it. And I started to notice a difference to the sound of the drums, especially the bass. I mean, it changed so much during that time.
Down for My Niggas by Snoop Dogg and C. Murray. I'm down for my niggas, what? If you go back and listen to that record, the kick drum, the low end of that record keeps dropping.
Yeah.
And you can't even really hear it. You feel it. It goes to a frequency that I had never heard a record. I had never heard the 808 being used below a certain drop. He dropped it down lower than what was average back then.
Mm-hmm.
And it's common now, but back then, when it came on, when it dropped, the frequency was below everything else. So when it came down so hard, when it hit the club, boom, 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 boom. And that's what I mean by, although it's an 808, you can use it in creative ways.
Well, that was a big part of why I got involved so deeply in doing rap records. I mean, I'd spent so much of the 90s, you know, trying to make these big records, but all the rock guys I was working with, they're just so careful. Rock was so established, and it just got boring for me, and nobody wanted to take any chances. And I started working on hip-hop and rap records, and those guys were like, yeah, go for it. There wasn't any idea or any sound they would say no to. They just gave me free rein to make massive, huge-sounding records.
That's amazing. And
I just think that Low End is so important to the sound of your record across all genres.
And you've been affiliated with some of the biggest artists whose careers were defined by the Low End. So you definitely know what you're talking about.
Now, when I first started working with Lil Jon, he played me some records that he really liked the sound of. He just wanted to make sure that we could match that sound. Frankly, I thought we could beat that sound. And I also figured that instead of just taking the sounds out of his MPC and recording them straight in, that we should run those sounds through my gear like I would do on a rock record, or I would like to do if my clients would let me and weren't being so careful. So I did that, and I'm going to show you right here what I did. I've never actually shown anybody this before, but I guess I'll show it now. Check it out. I would run the 808 bass drum through the Avalon VT-737 and start messing with the EQ. I wanted to find the punchy area, which is usually around 100 hertz, maybe a little above. They be it. Sometimes I'd add a little 60 hertz, and I'd make sure that the needle was popping hard because I like the way it hits the tubes and makes it sound. It's really kind of crazy to think about how many drums I recorded and mixed through this unit that have been resampled and used on other records. It's really nice to be part of history. By the time I'd really gotten into doing hip-hop and rap records, the evolution of the 808 bass drum was already well underway. It had been lengthened, pitched down, tuned so far that it had essentially become your bass part, and producers were layering shorter, punchier kick drum parts on top of them. So when people said 808, it essentially meant your bass or sub-bass instrument.
And they actually played it like an instrument. You heard that shit coming three blocks away. You knew what it was.
Yeah.
When people started toning it in that SB-12, that's what that machine right there, people sampling the 808 drum machine into the SB-12 and toning it.
Yeah.
I think those two machines put together is what developed the 808 into the monster that it is.
Absolutely.
Today.
When I started getting more mixes that had tuned 808s doing melodies, it really affected the way I mix songs. Before that, I could just set a sound on the 808 and leave it. But when you're pitching the 808 to play a melody like it's a bass, some of those notes are going to jump out more than others, and they're too loud or they're too quiet. So we would either put, multiband compressors on them, or more typically what I would do is I would split out the louder notes, drop them onto another track, and balance them that way.
You take the 808 that I use in the Whisper song. That particular sample of the 808 sounds like no other sample of an 808. So when I did that doom, 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 that 808 came across as being something we had never heard before.
Yeah.
Just by the way that the kick was sampled. It had a punch in it because there's no kick on top of that 808 in that song, if you remember.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
It's just that 808. It was punchy. It was solid. And it was short. It wasn't sustained.
As Southern rap was exploding onto the scene, especially crunk and Atlanta music, recording technology was evolving as well. The new tools allowed us to do things that nobody had ever done before, and the records we were making were becoming more sophisticated. Rap and hip-hop went from being this other genre just kind of over here to being mainstream pop music, and the 808 was moving into the mainstream as well.
Although it did not start in the South, we were affiliated with the sound of the 808 drum more than any other, area in the country. West Coast used it in dance music and the way they used it. The East Coast used it. But when we got hold to it, we just, our music, our sound was synonymous with the 808 drum. But now everybody uses it.
Well, it's become ubiquitous. It literally, it's one of the few sounds that I feel that has gone from hip-hop and rap, you hear it in rock, you hear it in country, pop. Right. Like, you hear this sound everywhere. So, you know, I got, when I started getting into country music, they would be like, hey, can you put an 808 there? Like on, you know, call the down. I'm like, really? Like, wow. You know? Yeah. So it, this one sound has like moved. It's become this thing that it's transferred across all these different genres.
When I started hearing it in country, it's like, wow. Cause now that shit dropping, you know, when a country record is just usually loud and they got the guitars. But now when you slide that 808 up under all that shit, it's dropping and it creates this its own shit that sounds nothing like hip hop when you put it in hip hop.
The 808 moving into the mainstream affected other things as well. I would say the 808 affected stereo speaker development.
I can believe that. It seems as if the main purpose of a subwoofer is the 808 drum. But to capture the full dynamic range of that 808 kick drum, the subwoofer, it just hits the sub like nothing else ever has and ever will.
Now, like I said before, new studio technologies such as mixing in the box, which is mixing on a computer, allowed us to do what had not been possible before. And one thing I started doing was to align the polarity of low frequency instruments such as the kick drum, the bass, and the 808 on a note by note basis. I have videos on this subject and the technique. I will leave links to them in the description section below. But the short explanation is that by chopping up the 808 note by note and moving it just a few milliseconds to align it with the kick or bass drum will give you a way huger low end and a very consistent low end. Now, I did this on a song called Gripping the Grain, which was produced by Avery Johnson, and it came out on Bone Crusher's album, Attention. And this was the result. These are videos of people playing Gripping the Grain on their home and car stereos to show off their subwoofers. I mean, look at this. It's in his back seat. Now, some of these are what they called chopped and screwed versions of the song, where they would re-release the song slowed down. That's a whole other story, but it's definitely increasing the low end. I mean, look at that. That's wild. Something that I mixed, you know, it's just like, there's a lot more of these videos out there. I just picked some of my favorites. This is a trunk rattler. You can even see the inside there moving. Look at that subwoofer in the trunk of his car. I mean, it's crazy. Look at that. I mean, it's got to, like, that's why you find all these, like, bolts and stuff on the ground on the side of the road. Look at these subwoofers. They look like freaking nuclear devices or something. And look, he's got a crack in his windshield up here, probably from doing this. Look at that. The glass is moving. I mean, the whole car is rattling. Yeah, that sucker's gonna, like, the car, like, not only gonna damage your ear, you're probably gonna damage your car. Look at this, watch when the camera comes outside. Look at his windshield, now watch this. Look at the glass. Oh yeah, this one, this guy is just, in this video, he actually has to stop because the police were driving by, but I love this one. This is my favorite one. Now this guy, look at the glass. And you see how he's got cracks in the windshield? Later on, he actually shows where he got new cracks.
I saw a new one.
He's like, yeah.
Where? It spread. This one just linked up.
Nice. Dude, your windshield is
It's incredible.
Gone.
It's like, I guess I finally got to make that huge low end that I always wanted to do. I always wanted to blow up speakers and do something huge. Well, I finally did it. But it wasn't too much long after mastering these low-end techniques that I started occasionally getting calls from clients who were saying, I can't hear the 808. And I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm the master at this thing. Like, what are you listening to these mixes on? And they'd say, my computer speakers. I'm like, come on, man. You got to listen on a stereo, you know, in your car or something like that. But I started getting more and more of these calls, and then people started calling up saying, well, I'm listening on earbuds. And then as time went by, I realized I can't fight this thing. This is what people are actually going to be listening to music on. I need to make some adjustments. So I moved to another technique. Let me show you what I started doing. So right here, I've got an 808 that I'm just looping. This is probably something I got from Lil Jon, and a very typical 808 for some of the early days, early 2000s, mid 2000s. The first thing I tried was to add some mid-range. Off a little bit, it's actually low mids. Then I thought, well, let me add a little saturation. Kind of helps a little bit, you know, difference between this and pops out on a little speakers more, but still didn't seem like quite enough. So I actually just tried plain old distortion. Here's one version of it. This is just a built-in plugin. I might not have been using quite so much back then, but something like that. But having the distortion on there like that would kind of actually suck out some of the low end. I still wanted that low end. So I actually ended up coming up with this technique. Actually used compression. This is not the compressor plugin I had back then because, well, it's a long story. But I found that by doing a very fast attack and fast release, you can get this distortion. Check it out. Like if I have a slow attack, you know, it gives it some slap and all that, but going to a very fast attack and fast release, it messes up the waveform a little bit. And then what I would do is actually put a high pass filter on it so that it was letting the low end through, and this effect was really only happening to stuff above, you know, like 50 hertz, 60 hertz and stuff like that. So I'd still get this low end, but I could really control this distortion and it would show up in little speakers. And now where the lines are a little blurred between rap, EDM, and pop, you can see this whole distorted 808 thing has just kind of gone to a level that's just not something I ever would have imagined, where you've got these things called glides, where they're pitching it up and down, which I think is pretty darn cool. But it's kind of crazy how it went from this to this. The thing I've kind of wondered about is, where is it going to go from here? Is it going to get more extreme, or are we going to go back more towards the original sound? Roland went ahead and reissued a new version of the TR-808 called the TR-08, which is pretty cool. And then you've got companies like TSL Audio and Studio Equipment who are creating completely pure analog devices to recreate these old school sounds. And I think that's awesome. Well, I hope you liked this episode. Thanks for watching. Remember to subscribe and always be unique.